7 out of 10 students on the web
say they're getting better grades.
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
Welcome to the broadcast. We're live in New York, in Austin, and in Washington. As we begin this live broadcast, the identity of the next president of the United States remains in question. While early results give Vice President Al Gore the lead in Florida and the Electoral College, a large number of people are giving the momentum and the edge in the vote to Governor Bush. Florida is undecided as we come to you. Joining me now for an examination of today's historic vote from Austin, Texas, Jay Carney of Time Magazine. In Washington, Michael Kinsley, editor of Slate Magazine. Here in New York, former Senator George Mitchell, Joe Klein of The New Yorker, author Fran Lebowitz, and Frank Rich of The New York Times. I'm pleased to have them. A little later in this broadcast, we'll be joined by other people. I begin now with Senator Mitchell and go around the horn here and get an impression of what they think about this election and what should be said about it so far, other than it's a cliffhanger. Senator.
Well, I'll begin with it's a cliffhanger. The conventional wisdom was correct. It's down to the wire, down to a few states now. Obviously, Florida's a key. I think if Bush wins Florida, it's over. If Gore wins Florida, then he needs one other state. That will be another cliffhanger. But I don't think anyone can now say for certain what's going to happen.
Joe.
I think it should be a lesson in humility for all parties concerned. We in the press, all the networks called Florida wrong earlier this evening. And for both candidates, if whoever becomes president is going to have to humbly create a bipartisan consensus and seek out the moderates of the opposite party. All of the big campaign promises you heard, George Bush's ridiculously huge tax cut and all the others, are all out the window now. They're gone.
All right. Fran.
To me, the interesting thing in watching the coverage is that all the coverage was about the coverage. And every single time they would talk about whatever state that we're winning or losing, the reasons never had to do with the fact that people might actually have a reason for voting other than listening to these people. You know, there was not one instance where they thought, well, maybe people were voting because they actually cared about something. This was not considered, no matter who was talking.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I saw some polls that people voted based on economic issues and those kinds of things.
But you're talking about, I'm talking about when they talked about the state by state.
Oh, state by state.
MSNBC, all the networks, CNN talked about the coverage or the campaign managers. It was all real inside media stuff.
It's horse race rather than anything else.
Yeah, I mean, a horse race is more honest than Charlie. Come on.
Go ahead. Well,
I've always felt Fran should be president, actually.
I have always felt that.
You know why she's here now.
Yeah. I think we're back where we started at the beginning of this race. We have two guys who have not captured the imagination of America. And so this was sort of fated to happen. In the broadest sense, the press was right. It was a close race. It was a close race because neither of these guys is commanding. And obviously what Joe says is correct. In the end, this is going to be a very divided government no matter who wins, and not a lot is going to happen. It's not going to happen with without a lot of cooperation from all sides.
Let me go to Jay Carney. He's in Austin, Texas. Jay, what's the mood in Austin as they await the results from Florida?
Well, as you would expect, Charlie, they're very anxious. This was a Bush campaign that for the last 8 days, during their last campaign swing on the road, I was with them, and the level of confidence and cockiness was really overwhelming. In Florida, where we spent the full day, the day before yesterday, top aide Karl Rove, Bush's chief strategist, was tossing around the football, talking about, you know, winning with 5 to 6 percentage points. in the popular vote and maybe 320 to 330 electoral votes. None of that's coming true. And if they squeak this one out, I think the humility will really be here on the Bush side, because they will have squeaked it out with a lot of luck.
What do they think is happening in Florida? And do we know if 80% of the vote is in or 85%? What counties have not reported? Is it Miami-Dade or where?
I think there are a number of precincts that haven't reported fully. The Democrats are optimistically saying that a number of them are more urban, which would favor them. And the Republicans are optimistically talking about their advantage, traditional advantage, in the large number of absentee ballots in Florida. We could, if this thing comes down to Florida, which it very well may because of the large number of electoral votes it offers, we could be up all night and maybe into the morning sorting through those absentee ballots. One point I'd like to make is that the Bush team is saying that the reason why they were wrong 2 days ago and yesterday about how this thing was going to turn out is they think, well, two things. One, African-American turnout has been higher than they expected.
Let me interrupt you just a second, Jay. Are you talking about the turnout overall around the country or just in Florida?
Now I'm spreading it out over the country. African-American turnout in key areas, I think, helped in Pennsylvania and Michigan especially. Also union, obviously, turnout in Michigan. But they also think, interestingly, that the Bush DUI story may, in the end, have taken some points out of the Bush column, because we saw some numbers earlier tonight that a lot of the last-minute deciders in this race were breaking towards Gore. And while we won't know until there are extensive exit poll interviews why that happened, the Bush team is speculating that it might have been because of the drunk driving arrest in 1976.
We have yet not mentioned the name other than of Ralph Nader. He's doing less well than we thought he might at 1 or 2%, 2% perhaps, right?
That's what I understand, and therefore has not really been a big factor, although conceivably he could be in the Pacific Northwest if it comes down to that.
Wisconsin, Iowa, Oregon, Washington. Those are places where Nader may cause Bush to win this election.
I've just been given word that some people have given Arkansas and Alaska to Governor Bush.
Well, he certainly has Alaska. I mean, if not, then that's a real upset. But Arkansas alone.
Well, since that's no longer Bill Clinton's home state, he probably isn't all that worried about it.
He's ours now.
Are you surprised by the fact that if this is true, that Al Gore has lost Arkansas and Tennessee?
No, both states have been trending Republican in recent years. In Tennessee, Gore's home state, the governor, the two senators, much of the congressional delegation is Republican. I'm sure it's very painful for Vice President Gore to lose his home state. It would be for anyone.
Jay, back to you about Ralph Nader. What are they saying about the Nader results this election night?
In Austin, Charlie, they're disappointed. They were counting on Ralph Nader, and still are, actually, to help them out on the West Coast and the Pacific Northwest, especially in Oregon. That's a state that they think they can win. Obviously, we don't know where that's going to go yet, although with the precincts reporting that we've seen so far, Nader's numbers aren't that high. They're about 4%. And earlier in this race, Nader was polling almost into the double digits in Oregon. So if his vote is suppressed, that might give the state to Gore and could nudge the vice president towards victory. Although I think Florida really may decide this.
Let me just say, though, in a race this close, 4% is a huge figure, particularly if concentrated in a single state that's on the edge.
Nader could very well be decisive on the results of this presidential election, because in decisive states like Oregon, he could tip the balance.
Or, as Joe says, Wisconsin.
Or in Wisconsin.
Others. So he could still be a decisive factor.
Michael Kinsley joins us now from Washington. Michael, tell me what you think of this election night and the results that we know.
Well, I missed a lot of the earlier discussion. I'm sure it was brilliant because of technical discussions here. And last I heard was Fran Lebowitz saying, deploring, as everybody does deplore, the horse race. I got to say, it's been a great horse race, and tonight's really a microcosm.
Jackie's
of
never
She's apologized. She likes horse races.
I'm not apologizing. Jackie's loved horse races.
It was really, tonight's a microcosm of the whole year. You know, last spring it looked like Gore had it, then Bush had it, then Gore had it, then Bush had it, and when they tonight backed off of Florida, that was really an amazing moment.
So who do you think is going to take Florida, Michael? What?
Well, as I said to you last night, Charlie, I'm a pessimist, and I'm voted for Gore, so naturally I think Bush is going to.
Well, you're consistent with your logic. The Nader factor we were talking about, it looks like it may be decisive in Oregon. It could play a role at those places where he's 3 or 4%, but nationwide has been less than some thought it might be.
Well, I think that Nader, it did look like he was going to be decisive, at least in the popular vote, didn't it?
Yeah, it could have that kind of impact.
Yeah.
I've also been told that CNN has reported Washington State for Gore, as I understand.
Oh, well, then my vote's in there.
So you voted in the state of Washington. So you may have been decisive in Washington.
What about your mother in Florida?
Is CNN a state now?
Well, we take...
I think soon you'll be reporting that.
Well, no,
which networks or how the networks are coming in?
We take information where we can get it, is our idea.
Does that mean the people in Washington like the Microsoft decision on the part of the government?
I don't know.
Well, the Microsoft decision actually was an issue in the Senate campaign.
And who won the Senate campaign?
It looked like Slade Gorton was way ahead I saw. He was running TV commercials, which were exactly like the TV commercials of every other politician, with one exception. He said, we're going to save Social Security, we're going to give drugs to old people, and we're going to protect Microsoft from the Justice Department. And I thought that's sort of amazing that should be a statewide motherhood and apple pie issue.
Yeah. The performance by labor in turning out the vote, especially in Michigan. Do you think the fact that John Sweeney negotiated in his last FL-CIO contract that union members had election day off?
That's one of those interesting things to speculate about, but I don't think we'll ever have any evidence to substantiate it or to refute it. It clearly was a strong effort by labor in key states, including Michigan and Pennsylvania, that were very important for Gore. So it's obvious that it was a lot of help. Whether it was attributable to the day off, I don't think anyone will ever really know.
As I said, everybody needs to be humble after this. Moderate Democrats, the DLC, have always denigrated the role of labor and minorities in winning presidential elections. This year, if Gore wins, even the fact that Gore has gotten this close seems a tribute to the fact that labor and minorities came out.
You just recently did a very interesting, good piece about the president in the New Yorker magazine. He's here in New York tonight congratulating his wife on her victory in the Senate campaign. Any sense of how he felt about Gore's campaign?
Well, I mean, all the rumors that you heard were that he was infuriated by it and very frustrated by how inept Gore was. I think that you got to say Gore ran a pretty inept campaign, but I don't have any direct knowledge.
It was such a surreal moment tonight to see Hillary Clinton's victory speech with him there as second fiddle.
Cheerleading.
Yeah.
And Prince sort of Philip.
Prince Philip, exactly. Chelsea sort of is the wall between them. Yeah. It was just strange. And her survival is, in some ways, to me, so far, the most interesting story of the night. I mean, I guess we expected her to win this race against Rick Lazio, but she's sort of so come into her own, and, you know, you wondered if Gore won, whether she'd be challenging him in a primary in 4 years. But
here's a question people are speculating about, and you're the politician among the group, that if, in fact, George Bush wins the presidency, does she become a contender for president in the year 2004?
Well, she certainly gets right onto the top of the list of the mentioned by the mentioners.
She goes right there.
There's one politician and four mentioners. And the mentioners will mention her. There's no doubt about it. But listen, let me tell you, I told her, I saw her about a week or so ago, I said, this is the easy part, waiting to get to the Senate. it's really tough to get anything done there.
Yeah, of course, I remember what you said to me, that negotiating the Senate was nothing compared to negotiating and trying to find peace in Ireland.
That's true. It was tougher.
If Fran is right and CNN is a state, she's already won the primary.
When he says she, he means her, but he doesn't mean me.
No, I understand that. Jay Carney.
Yes.
The good Bush people, do they think now as they look back that what do they think they did right and what do they think they did wrong in this campaign?
Well, it's interesting, Charlie, because what they did was enlarge the electoral map. Instead of focusing on the obvious battleground states exclusively, like Pennsylvania, Michigan, Ohio, which ended up not being much of a battleground, Missouri, Wisconsin, they enlarged the map because the map had opened up to them. Places like Arkansas and Tennessee, West Virginia, which they won tonight, a Democratic state almost all the time in presidential elections. And they went hard because they had so much money, the Republican Party did, and the state parties committees did, and played in those states. And they dedicated George W. Bush's time to those states. And I'll tell you, one of the most interesting moments for me in this campaign was in our last stop before coming to Texas last night, we went to Arkansas. And earlier in the morning, we went to Tennessee. And this was a direct poke in the eye that the Bush campaign was inflicting on Bill Clinton and Al Gore. And it was a remarkable rally in Northwest Arkansas. And one of the funnest things about it was just before George Bush came on stage, the speakers erupted in music, and it wasn't the traditional song they normally play. It was Don't Stop Thinking About Tomorrow by Fleetwood Mac. Right? And then it stopped, and suddenly it was Won't Get Fooled Again by The Who. And the Bush team was high-fiving them, you know, each other, and the crowd was going wild. And look, it paid off. They won those two states. But what's interesting to me about it is if Bush loses this election narrowly by losing Florida or maybe some other state that he should have won, they may have looked back and decided that that was a mistake, that the revenge factor of sort of mocking the Clinton era and kind of erasing it by taking Arkansas, by taking Tennessee, might have been a mistake. Not that they might not have ended up with those states anyway, but there's always a finite amount of resources and a finite amount of time that a candidate has, and they decided to spread them around a lot, including in some of those states that don't offer a lot of electoral votes, and they may have sacrificed some of the bigger states.
My sense is that if Bush loses this election, that the great question for him is, why did I spend all that money in California and not spend all that money in Florida, would be the big self-doubting about them.
I'll tell you why they did this. Bush promised he would when Californian Republicans came to him early on and asked him to run, and because he decided that if he was going to be president, and in some ways this is a noble and smart political decision, that if he was going to be president, and to be a powerful president, he had to have a powerful political base in the largest state in the union. He knew, I think, in his heart that he wasn't going to win California. I could tell that in the kind of discussions we have with him, you know, that are technically off the record. He never said he wasn't going to win, but it wasn't like he was convinced he was going to. But I think he felt that he had to make a strong effort there so that maybe in 2004 he could win, or at the very least he could count on that base of support and a re-energized California Republican Party, because the GOP doesn't want to spend the next 3, 4, 6 cycles writing California off. Eventually, that could really hurt them and prevent them from ever winning the White House.
Let me throw this question out, because you've touched on it, and I'd love to hear, Senator, and Joe, because of Bill Clinton. It was said about the president that he changed the Democratic Party, that it made it more centrist party. Does this election change anything about party and where the party draws its strength, both Democrats or Republicans? What's the next twist of the cycle of political party alignment?
I think it's a coming back to the center. I think that the politics of the previous decades in which candidates tended to be more aggressive toward their extremes is over, and parties are now turning to the center. Bush has now completed that coming back. He will have done a remarkable thing if he wins. No Republican in American history has ever been elected president while losing the two largest states. Never happened. Only two Democrats have done it, Woodrow Wilson and Harry Truman. And so Bush will deserve credit, I think, for running a skillful campaign, bringing his party back to the center. He has remarkably ignored the Republican congressional leadership. It's as though they didn't exist in this campaign because they were perceived as too harsh, too right, too aggressive. And so I think it's coming back. The American elections traditionally are won in the center. And I think that's what
it's
this
interesting you say that, because you didn't hear, you heard a little bit of it here in New York. You didn't hear much talk about Newt Gingrich in this presidential election.
No.
As you've had in so many
past years. I asked the Gore people why Gore never used the words Newt and Gingrich in tandem during the debates, and they said it didn't test well. And that's part of why, you know, I think that the question that you asked is a really good one, and it's premature to answer it, because even though we're very down to the nub of this election, whoever loses this, whichever party loses this, there are going to be vast and bitter recriminations. And so it's hard to say which way the party is going to go. Democratic Party could very easily swing to the left if Gore loses. And by the way, if Bush loses this, the big question isn't why did I spend $12 million in California? It's why was I so smug?
Yeah.
But also,
well, Mike, I'm coming to you in just 1 second. I wanted you to know that, but Frank,
just
sorry.
The mirror image of what might happen in the Democratic Party is if Bush loses, the right, the hard right of that party, which has really been very, very quiet during this election and sat on its hands and everyone's gotten into line to try this experiment with a winner, a moderate winner,
right,
is going to say, well, that didn't work, and so now let's go back to principles, and there could be some sort of civil
war in the
Republican
Party.
Well,
see, that's exactly the opposite thing that I think.
What world is Bush a moderate? He's just
in
a
their
secret.
World.
He's just kept it quiet. I don't think Bush is a moderate in any way.
Well,
I think Bush has just been very quiet about his more right-wing opinions. You think Bush is a moderate?
No, but I think people think... I think he has conservative opinions as well as moderate opinions, but I think in terms of an outreach and in terms of the way he's reacted to the Republican Congress has been more moderate than you might have expected from others.
I think he's pretended to be moderate, but I don't think he's a moderate at all.
Let me go to Michael. Michael Kinsley, talking about party realignment after this and in terms of the campaign that's been run and the nominees and the positions they staked out and the results of this election, what it has.
All right. I'll do all that, Charlie.
Okay.
First, I just wanted to say to Joe that isn't the question of why he was so smug and why he spent money in California sort of the same question? this California to Arkansas, Tennessee thing was sort of the physical, geographical expression of that smirk which he'd suppressed for so long, it seems to me.
That's right.
And to Senator Mitchell, I hope it's true that both parties are moving to the center, but of course Gore sort of moved to the left, oddly, during his campaign, and the fact that Ralph Nader did fairly well will tempt him even further to the left, possibly. The Republicans wanted to win. They were hungrier than the Democrats. They were like Democrats felt in 1992. Mm-hmm. And I suppose the Christian right and the other right-wing elements of the Republican Party think that by lying low, they helped him get elected, if he is elected, and now he will pay them off. And we'll see if that happens or not. They'll be very bitter if he doesn't.
Well, while we're at it, let's answer Fran's question. Is George Bush a moderate or is he posing as a moderate? Michael?
Yes, sir.
Is he posing as a moderate or is he, by some litmus paper test, a moderate?
I think he is a person of no strong policy or political views, posing as a conservative who is then posing as a moderate.
That's exactly right. It's a compassionate conservative.
And only the last pose is going to get stripped away, I'm afraid.
Joe said he can't top that.
I can't top that, and he certainly has conservative positions on a number of issues, but on a number of other surprising issues, especially those involving programs that have to do with poor people, particularly education, particularly those in those areas where he's had practical personal experience as governor, he has been a moderate.
And he also, in terms of clearly reaching out to...
For votes.
Whatever reason. I mean, but once you start accusing one candidate other of taking position because they're reaching out for votes, then, I mean, the cynicism applies to all of them.
I mean, that's what politicians
do. Or as John Kennedy
do.
Said to somebody, he said, this speech is about getting votes, it's not about policy.
Not
during the election, though.
Ask that question, you must ask compared to what? What is the context?
Right.
And in my judgment, within the context of the Republican Party in the year 2000, Governor Bush is a moderate. Within that context.
Compared to DeLay.
Compared to DeLay,
Army, and leadership of the Senate.
But the question that, to me, is not answered about Bush is, I happen to feel, as Mike does, he doesn't have great convictions. And how much of a spine does he have? And when DeLay and company go after him in Washington, how much is he going to bend? This is a guy who's not been much tested by a lot.
I think we saw some evidence of that last year when DeLay and company wanted to wipe out the earned income tax credit that goes to poor people, and Bush stood up and said, no. I thought it was, it was a nice sign.
It's a nice sign, but we don't really have much of a...
And they backed down as a result.
While we're at this, our focus now is on Bush for a while, and we don't know the results, and if we know them before we go off the air here, we'll give them to you. If somebody else, even if it's CNN, we will report who has called Florida. But before we do, Jay Carney, do you think the Bush people ran a good campaign, a superb campaign?
I'd start with a good campaign. I think they did. They were up against an enormous disadvantage, or rather a Gore advantage, because he was an incumbent vice president in the most peaceful and prosperous times we've ever known, and Gore is at best going to pull this out in a squeaker, and he might lose, in fact. George W. Bush ran, I think, a smart campaign by at least posing, if that's what he's doing, posing as a moderate, certainly toning down the Republican rhetoric, even as he put forward conservative positions. I think that was probably the smartest thing he did. We saw it at the Republican convention. We saw a reaching out to minority voters, especially Hispanics, that I think if Bush wins, will, I think, continue. He'll set the tone from the White House. I think it was a smart campaign, and I think it will move the party, maybe slowly, but move the party to the center. I think he made some mistakes, one of them being that he simply didn't work as hard as Al Gore. Even in this last week, traveling with Governor Bush, when we had our longest, most arduous week of the campaign, I was struck by how many longer days the vice president was out there. His days were much longer on the campaign trail than they were for Governor Bush.
My argument on either way on that, in terms of how you campaign, depends on what your own stroke is. That some people, Ronald Reagan, George Bush, and others, find their own rhythm. Others, like Bill Clinton, I don't know how you were, but Bill Clinton and Al Gore, just are passionate about going at it 24 hours a day.
Well, I think most people, when you're in a race this tight, go at it 24 hours a day, because you've invested a lot of time and effort, and you've got plenty of time later to take it easy. Can I just say one thing about Bush? If he wins, there are so many issues. There are so many challenges that a president faces that, with any reasonable degree of skill, he can placate these conservative groups. It's obvious to see how. The Supreme Court's the clearly obvious way he can do that. Meanwhile, take moderate positions on other things. So I think that he has done a good job of pulling together his party, unifying it. I think, in part, Michael's right that the Republicans wanted to win badly, having been out for 8 years, but you have to give him credit for pulling together and having a unified party going into the election. I think if he wins, he ought to be able to keep them reasonably unified, although with the close margins in both houses, it's not likely he's going to put through any of his major initiatives.
And you also suggesting that regardless of who wins the presidency, you're not looking for a mandate, and you're not looking for a brilliant 100 days in the FDR tradition to take place in Washington, D.C. come January.
I said earlier, I think mandate is an overused word. I think it's an analyst's invention, and nobody will come out of this election with a mandate.
All right. Fran, just last word on this, how you saw this campaign.
I don't think brilliant's a word you're going to be having here too often either. I think that's a word that we're going to stop hearing.
What did you think of the campaign? What did you think of the Al Gore campaign? And were you enthusiastic for...
I don't think Al Gore is as dull as everyone else thinks he is. I mean, I don't think he's fascinating, you know, but I don't think that he was as... I think that the tremendous dullness of Al Gore is kind of an invention, you know. I mean, I didn't find Clinton so mesmerizing either, except his behavior. But I mean, as a speaker, you know, this isn't Winston Churchill. I think that too much contrast was made between these, between Clinton and Gore in their style, because Clinton kind of glitters with all this scandal, which people say they don't like, but which draws him very much.
Well, but you'll get a lot of differences here with Joe Klein, who believes he's the most brilliant politician, Clinton, that he's seen in several generations.
Yeah, and I think that we should go back to a point that Frank made at the very top, right, which is, and it plays into the lack of brilliance on both sides here, is that neither of these guys, both of them were kind of smaller than life. Neither of them took a single position that I would call courageous with regard to their base. They never surprised me. They never said something that didn't test well. They, by contrast, Clinton said things that tested well in 92, but they also were things that went up in the face of his base, like welfare reform, you know, crime and other issues.
Last word, Frank, as we can close this out. What is the most surprising thing about this election for you so far?
I guess how inept the Gore campaign was. Gore, what everyone thinks of him, he's a bright guy. He's someone who's obviously suited to this office. And his inability to come to a point about anything in the debates and much of his public discourse, he wasn't just lacking a big vision or
as Joe was saying, the ability to have challenging positions that might go against his base. But even as, you know, in the last weeks of the campaign, he couldn't come up with a position on dome stadiums. I mean, he really could not take a stand on anything, and I think it cost him dearly. He may squeak through, but it was a shockingly inept campaign, I think.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Fran. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Senator Mitchell. Pleasure to have you here this evening. As we change some of the seats at this table, I'm going to throw it back to Jay and to Michael because they will be away as we change microphones and stuff, and have both of you reflect on the Gore campaign, win or lose. If he wins, it'll be a squeaker. If he loses, it'll also be a squeaker, but he will, in fact, have lost. Give me a sense of the Gore campaign, Jay, and then Michael, speak to it as well. Jay?
I think the Gore campaign will have to examine, if they lose, a couple of key decisions. One was the decision at the convention to go pretty hard to the left with the populist message, the essentially a class warfare message, even though it was warfare on behalf mostly of the middle class, but it was against big corporations and big oil, big pharmaceutical companies. At a time of relative prosperity, that's a tough message to sell to independent swing voters. If he loses, I think they'll have to look back on that and maybe think they made a mistake, especially since we were hearing at the convention as they shifted into this message that they would shift out of it towards the fall in order to pick up those independent swing voters. They never shifted out of it. I also think they'll have to examine why they decided to keep such a distance from Bill Clinton. I think the public, while it has an unfavorable opinion of him as a person, I think those moderate swing voters generally gave Bill Clinton very high marks as president, and Al Gore's decision to totally disassociate himself from the president made it very hard for him to associate himself with this 8 years of remarkable prosperity and progress on social issues, the decline in crime and teen pregnancy. I think those were mistakes. And finally, I think the election may have turned on one exaggeration in the first debate, that point that Al Gore just had to make, that he had flown to Texas with James Lee Witt, basically obliterated Gore's advantage in that debate, gave Bush a message to take into the next few debates that Gore was an exaggerator, prevaricator, and it stuck. And I think it really, really hurt Al Gore, who probably should have emerged from those debates with a healthy lead.
Michael, what did you think of the Gore campaign, win or lose?
Well, I think it was inept whether he does win or lose. Obviously, it's going to be very close. So it would be absurd to say it was brilliant if he wins and terrible if he loses. And Jay is right that the populist thing was bizarre and didn't seem to make much sense. On this exaggeration issue, I think that more accurately illustrates the brilliance of the Bush campaign to turn a series of rather minor exaggerations into something which exit polls tonight show was the major issue for people, was honesty, the implication being that Gore is not honest when, in my view at least, Bush was more dishonest about other things. And at the very least, Gore never engaged on that issue, which was certainly a mistake.
Okay, we're back with new people here at this table, and I am pleased to welcome Jay continues with us from Austin, Michael continues with us from Washington, D.C., but here at the table, Al Sharpton, president of the National Action Network, Margaret Carlson of Time Magazine, Kurt Andersen of inside.com, and Adam Gopnik of the New Yorker magazine, who's been reporting for French television or somebody else this evening, so we look forward to his perspective. Margaret Carlson first. Tell me what your reaction is to this election based on what we know so far.
Well, we've been saying for a long time it's going to come down to Florida. And now it has. And I think 86% of the votes are counted, and Bush is 100,000 ahead. Fortunately for Gore, a lot of the votes not counted are in Dade and Broward County down around Miami Beach. But unfortunately for Gore, the absentee ballots aren't in yet, and those will probably go Republican. Traditionally they do, although in Florida it may not be quite that much. So it you know, Lieberman, who is going to be the great savior here by delivering Florida, may not have done what everyone thought he alone could do for Gore. Certainly the Elian Gonzalez pander, which we've sort of forgotten, wasn't going to get Gore over the top, but Lieberman was.
In the end, does your instinct say, based on what you know and what you're hearing tonight, that Bush wins Florida, or is it just too close?
Well, somebody said, this election is so close, Dick Cheney voted.
That's as good a line as I've heard.
Let me leave it there. It is awfully close.
Turnout among African Americans.
I think clearly around the country, turnout was great. I think no matter what happens tonight, there certainly is going to be a realignment in the Democratic Party, because labor and African Americans can clearly say that we came through in many places in unprecedented numbers, when clearly Gore and others came back to the issues that are deeply of concern to us late in the campaign. So even if he wins tonight, the whole, in my judgment, new Democrat phenomenon that Bill Clinton introduced may die in this election tonight, or at least be up for debate.
Yet at the same time, Bill Clinton is more popular with African Americans than anybody in
presidential politics. I think this election will cause a realignment in terms of philosophy. Bill Clinton, a lot of his popularity is his own charisma. I mean, here's a guy that, if it wasn't him, that had introduced certain things that we definitely would not have accepted. So again, I think there'll be a paradigm shift. I think the fact that it looks like the House will not go Democratic, there's going to be a lot of fallout on this, no matter what happens tonight. I agree with Margaret, though. I think the absentee ballots give me cause for concern in Florida, even though it's Dade County that's out, because they tend to always go more Republican.
All right. Kurt?
Well, I think if Reverend Sharpton's right and there's a realignment to the left of the Democratic Party, that would be to the misfortune of the Democratic Party, frankly. The hopeful view of that, if George Bush wins and the Democratic Party moves left, that perhaps there's a space there for a third party that is not Ralph Nader based. I mean, that's my fond and perhaps quixotic dream, is that there's a Bob Kerry, Bill Weld third party that is one that could actually excite the disaffected voters of the sensible middle.
Sane Ross Perot.
There you have it. I also think that, you know, my sense of this campaign, I know there were serious issues and big issues involved, but it was a campaign for president between two candidates about whom I think each of their parties were ultimately unenthusiastic. The horse race aspect, which became so much the focus of this campaign, even down to this very moment, I think the fact that that was the great story of this campaign and remains so, will continue to reinforce that as what national politics is all about.
You mean, which is always about horse races? Or?
I think in this case it is. That's by far, I think, the most engaging part of this campaign, yeah, is will Florida go for Bush or Gore?
Okay, but at this point it has to be, because we're talking about who's going to be the next president. So how Florida goes will determine that. So why shouldn't we be focused on that, would be my question.
I'm not saying we shouldn't be. Of course we should be, and of course we are. But my point is that this 11th hour, 12:48 horse race obsession has far overclipsed the sort of engagement that the campaign itself provided.
You have fresh eyes to this because you just come back to the country and living in Paris, in France, for 5 years.
Absolutely. The two things that struck me most, one was a small thing, one a big thing. The small thing was when we turned on the television 7 o'clock tonight to watch this, the election for the leader of not just of this country, but effectively of the world right now, the United States having that kind of power. The first thing we heard was, Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune will not be seen tonight in order that we may bring you the following special program. And I thought, only in America, right, would you need to make the announcement before the national election every 4 years for all the people who are planning to watch Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune on Tuesday night. That was the small thing that struck me. The big thing that struck me, and this is sort of a big thing, I hope I can say it simply, is that I just come from a country, France, where I've lived for 5 years, where all the legitimacy lies on the left. By that I don't mean that leftists win every election. They don't. I don't mean that leftists dominate every debate, because they don't. I just mean that all the hidden assumptions, all the taboos, all the things you can't say. You can't say in France capitalism without saying, I don't believe in savage capitalism. I don't believe in wild capitalism. You always have to protect yourself against all the taboos of the left. What strikes me is that here in America, to a degree that most Americans aren't aware of, all the legitimacy lies on the right. all of the hidden assumptions, all the basic ways that people talk about things. My favorite example is healthcare, right? You cannot find an American who will not talk about Hillary Clinton's healthcare initiative except as a catastrophe, a disaster, a fiasco, which in political terms, I dare say it was. But in terms of, in world terms, in terms of the industrialized world, it was an extremely timid, tentative attempt to bring the United States just into line with what was taken for granted, so sort of commonplace.
Is there a hit for criticizing Hillary as much as it is?
And they misled you because the wheel of fortune may have ended tonight, and we are.
let me, Michael. You were here with me last night. Someone made the point that the missing discussion in this presidential campaign was health care.
I think I made that point.
That's my recollection, too.
It must be true, that certainly universal health care is the most pressing issue we face, and it was not part of the campaign. However, I think Kurt is wrong to complain that this campaign was more horse race and less issues than others. He is right to say that the issues were very boring, but I think that may be a problem with his ideal vision of a campaign devoted to issues. You had Gore talking about the drug benefit and Bush talking about privatizing Social Security and vouchers, and there were, in that first debate, my plan has this and his plan has that. That's what I'm afraid to tell you a campaign about issues is like, Kurt.
I don't want a campaign about issues. I didn't mean, if I suggested that I didn't like the horse race, I apologize. I think what this, an interesting outcome of this election, if George Bush wins, in fact, is abortion. I think that is, has replaced Social Security as the sort of third rail of American politics. If George Bush wins and then has to pay back his right-wing supporters by actually pushing some anti-abortion constitutional amendment, and indeed, if he appoints 3 or 4 or 5 Supreme Court justices, and indeed they overturn Roe v. Wade, I think that could send the Republicans out of office for generations.
Right. Let me ask one question of you, Reverend Sharpton. Did Al Gore run a good campaign?
Well, I think that no one would say that he could not have done other things. I mean, you're dealing with an incumbent vice president during relatively good economic times as well as peacetime, who is on a cliffhanger tonight and may lose. So clearly he could not be it could not be considered they ran a great campaign.
Should this have been an easy race for a Democrat?
I think in any normal circumstance we would think that it would have been a walkthrough. Clearly tonight, no matter what happens, Al Gore certainly has to evaluate what went wrong, which is why I'm not even saying that ideologically, because I'm considered on the left, that's where politically the party ought to go. I'm saying realistically, the left will take advantage of this because they will say, see, if you had not done ABC, we were the only ones that showed up. Now, that may not work, but that's certainly going to be everybody.
Michael Kinsley will now tell you the argument will be made on the other side about why the Democratic Party missed an opportunity here because it wasn't centrist enough. Michael.
Well, I would be interested to know from Reverend Sharpton what he thinks Al Gore should have done differently, because I would have thought that Al Gore ran the kind of campaign that Reverend Sharpton would like.
Well, I don't think that Al Gore really took George Bush on in a lot of issues in a very aggressive and way that would really play to his base. I think in many ways, when he started to fight, he kind of backed, even in the debates. The second debate, I thought he was doing a rope-a-dope, and at the end of the debate, he ended up looking like the dope. I don't know that just because of the last 3 or 4 weeks he started going to a lot of black churches and all, that means that he came with enough of the kinds of clarity between he and Bush that he needed to pull out what he needed to pull out. I don't know that I agree with that.
He's a bad candidate. As the presentation, the performance is bad and unappealing, and I think that was clear years ago and was clear in this campaign?
You know what, I think the divide is really, and I think it was some psychologist, Marvin Seligman, I think his name was, said this, that in any confrontation in American politics between an optimist and a pessimist, the optimist always wins. Yep. It doesn't say the optimist is right, because most intelligent people, and Bill Clinton too, and not just an optimist in the sense of a cheery person, but somebody who's impervious to criticism.
There used to be a preface to that, which is all things being equal, mm-hmm. the optimist wins or the more likable guy wins. In fact, a lot of people would say all things weren't equal here and that you had somebody with 30 years experience and somebody named Bush with much less experience.
But I think the point is that even when things are not equal in that sense too, there's something, it's not just an optimist in the sense of somebody likable or somebody smiling. I think Gore in that second debate, what people really drew from it wasn't so much that he was weak as somebody who's that vulnerable to criticism, somebody who will change his approach, not because it makes him look like a weak character, but it makes him look like somebody who's pessimistic, somebody who absorbs criticism and takes it in.
Charlie, when you asked about the campaign, there's just one thing about the campaign that sticks with me, which is right before that second debate, his team sat him down fed him the Saturday Night Live parody of the debate, and then
said, "Which is a way of saying to them, this is how bad you are.
This is how bad you are. Now go and
be good.
Be good." No one does that as a way of preparing. As a matter of fact, if we all watched this tonight and then had to be on here tomorrow night, we'd be paralyzed.
That's true.
Yeah.
But not you, Charlie.
I think the optimist also would usually be the incumbent. I mean, if it was the guy that should have been the optimist here, it should have been the guy that says, look at the prosperity for the last 8 years. Yeah. In some ways, Bush's attitude seemed more like the incumbent, even though his policy certainly would
not. Let me go back to Austin. Jay, are you listening?
Yes, I am.
Does any of this make sense to you in terms of overall attitude when they reflect on how Bush campaigned versus how Gore campaigned?
Absolutely. I think Gore made a decision by distancing himself from Clinton that he had to play the role of the populist fighter as opposed to the role of, you know, the heir apparent of not just, you know, the Democratic Party leadership in the White House, but of a successful series of economic policies and social policies that had led to unprecedented prosperity and social progress in many areas. And I think Bush is naturally optimistic, but he was more than cheerful. And I think we were talking about issues, and the issues were sort of crunchy and dull and not, sort of earth-shaking. But Bush did some very interesting things on the issues, and that is he touched the third rail by talking about Social Security and partial privatization. A lot of Republicans on the Hill thought he was crazy to do that, and while his position was not exactly one that bucked the base of his party, it certainly made his base nervous in a presidential election. And at least looks like he did it without paying any major price. In fact, I think he'll have, if he has any mandate at all, he'll have a small mandate to try to do something with Social Security along those lines, because we're seeing that at least some of the returns out of Florida, that the senior vote may have broken even.
At one point, I saw the early polls suggested that more for Bush than for Gore in Florida.
Well,
thinking about 50-something to...
Exactly. So not only did Bush play on Democratic territory on the electoral map by going to states that Dukakis won and the home states of Al Gore and Bill Clinton, but he played on Democratic issues. And in a way, that he had to, because where else are you going to play at the end of 8 years when these issues have been so successful for the Democrats and when there are no traditional Republican issues like the Soviet Union or rising crime or welfare queens to fight against? So in that sense, again, you were asking earlier about, you know, did Bush run a smart campaign? I think he did. I think it was a risky campaign, but it might have been the only one he could run, and it looks like it might be successful.
Obviously, what we're doing here this evening is we're talking about what if, because we do not know the end result of this, and no one knows who is the next president. So we continue to look at the campaigns that will run and what the implications are and where do we go for the next 4 years. Let me just stay with one more what if. Would John McCain on the ticket or Tom Ridge on the ticket have made a difference, do you think, for George Bush? And he may win or he may not win. If McCain, in a race this close, was on the ticket, or Ridge, would it probably have made a difference? Jay.
Boy, I think so, Charlie. I think in each case, it would have helped George W. Bush. I don't see where Cheney helped Bush electorally. I think he helped Bush personally. I think he made Bush feel more comfortable. And when Cheney did so well against Joe Lieberman in the vice presidential debate, I know that George W. Bush felt like he had made a smart decision. But look, Tom Ridge, I think, would have probably made Pennsylvania much more competitive, maybe given it to George W. Bush, at which point we'd probably now be calling a race for the governor. And I think John McCain would have made Bush competitive in a host of states. I mean, he is still, I think, by most polls, the most popular politician in America, so I don't see how he couldn't have helped, although I think there was no chance that was ever going to happen, because frankly, even though John McCain was the good soldier out there for George W. Bush, these guys don't like each other, and it's apparent anytime you can talk privately with those who know them best.
If Al Gore wins this election, John McCain is the front runner for the Republican nomination in 2004?
If Al Gore wins this election, there's a total upheaval within the party, in the Republican Party. The right and left, the right and center split apart. John McCain becomes the champion of the moderate Republicans, the ones who see that they need to embrace things like campaign finance reform if they're going to win back the White House. And then there'll be the traditional conservative Republicans who say that the problem with George W. Bush, the reason why he lost, was because he was too moderate. And we need to return to our true Reagan roots. Bush wasn't Reagan enough. He might have been optimistic, he might have been for a big tax cut, but he wasn't enough like Ronald Reagan. And I think you'll just see a lot of blood in the water in the Republican Party, because if Bush loses, this is the third straight presidential election they've lost. We'll see what we saw with the Democratic Party after 1988, which is a total rethinking of how they approach this election. For the Democrats, the decision in the end was to go with Bill Clinton and pick someone in the center. John McCain may be the front runner after tonight or tomorrow or Friday, if that's when we find out who wins. But it won't be long before the right pushes forward figures that they want to take the lead and become the front runner, because a lot of right-wing or conservative Republicans simply can't abide by John McCain.
Your Time Magazine column. I got 3 minutes left. Here, go.
Hey, Jay.
No, I don't.
Take a deep breath. No, I was just thinking, as Jay was describing this positioning, is that, you know, we remember Reagan Democrats. What we might have with George Bush is the first Clintonian Republican, in that he occupied all of the space that Clinton did, because Gore gave it up to him. Gore pretended like the last 8 years were secret, never talked about them. And Bush got the affect of Clinton, which is the optimism and the genial way. And he occupied most of the new Democratic spaces and compassionate conservatism. So while he didn't go where Reverend Sharpton wanted him to go, Al Gore was just over here in this teeny tiny corner.
Yeah, I mean, does this election and coverage of it change the way the media does its business at all? Anything changed because of
I think one thing that changes is a meaningful issue today because the race is so close, is the kind of agreement on the part of the media that exit polling on election day would remain the secret of the media mandarins until 8 o'clock at night. I think the internet, for instance, changes that. I think that's
everybody had it,
and everybody was going around. So I think, you know, as another step of transparency and of breaking the sort of traditional institutional hold on this is information that we can have and that you can't, that's probably more of a good thing than a bad thing.
This is way off the base, but let me ask this anyway. If Bush wins, Colin Powell probably Secretary of State, Condoleezza Rice probably be National Security Advisor, serve as a great moment for African Americans?
Well, it's according to the policy. I mean, Colin Powell served before, and there were certain things he did, that invasion of Grenada. I mean, you know, Clarence Thomas is on the Supreme Court.
I
wouldn't exactly
left,
say he's a role model that I would want to extol for black children.
Thomas and Colin
Powell. Of course not, but it's according to policy. You know, I'm sure George Bush will smile and make everybody, make us feel that it's great as he does us in. I thought he was going to say the DWI was really him a victim of being profiled. I mean,
probably wasn't me.
Last comment, because I'm just trying to get around.
Defeat for the information age, right? Everybody talks about the information, virtual reality, and all those things. I go in to vote tonight, right? It's like a machine that was made sometime in 1949 where you pull a big lever, and they're counting absentee ballots. They're opening envelopes in Florida right now to find out who won. You know, there's a lot of juice left in the old...
My thanks to Washington for two nights helping me get through this. Michael Kinsley, thank you, Michael.
Thanks, Charlie.
Pleasure. Jay Carney from Time Magazine down in Austin. Al Sharpton.
Thank you.
Margaret Carlson. Kurt Andersen.
and Adam Gopnik. We thank you for joining us in live broadcast from New York. As we close, we do not know what is happening in Florida, and so we will leave this table eagerly, turning to other places to find out what happened. But thank you for joining us for this analysis, and we will see you tomorrow night. See you then.
Out of 10 students on the web.
Saying they're getting better grades.
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.